When a new continuous query is coming to the system, it is first of all registered. Then the system generates a query execution plan and tries to merge this plan with existing plans by other queries. Users also have the opportunity to create and manipulate plans directly. Plans consist of operators, queues, and states, and there is a global scheduler for plan execution. There are more topics to data stream processing or data stream management systems. There is, of course, special implementation tricks required, also optimization techniques, and a technique called load shedding, when a system cannot handle the load anymore and it has to deliver results in real time, then load shedding is applied to get rid of some of the data or processing overhead. So these concepts would be an own full lecture for one semester by itself, so we are not going into detail here. When looking at query processing inside a data stream management system, conceptually, we have the same issues that we have seen already in traditional database management systems, but they differ in many aspects. For instance, you have continuous queries, not ad hoc queries. You have a push-based model, not a pull-based model. And looking at real-time processing and memory-efficient algorithms, as we have sketched earlier already, like sampling and so on. And here also, when you want to guarantee real-time processing, as I mentioned, you're looking at load shedding algorithms to handle the overload. And specifically for data stream management systems, there's a large hope that you can share intermediate results. So this is going into the area of multi-query optimization. So when a query comes into the system, it is compiled into a query execution plan, similar to what you know already from relational database management systems. However, there's a big difference between data streams and databases. Well, the relational data is here actively streaming in. And this, of course, changes the way the operators are connected and interact in the query execution plan. Here in the left side, we have description of the pull model. This is like the traditional model used in database systems. Here, the consuming operator retrieves results from producing operators. So you have here, for instance, a projection operator and a selection operator and a join operator. And then the application that wants to read the results will pull here at the topmost operator, which would then send this pull request down to the selection operator, and the tuples are then pulled from the relations up through these individual operators. In the push model, it is different. Here, the, for instance, sensor nodes are producing data, and this data is then actively pushed to operators like a projection that is then for the incoming tuple that was pushed by the data source, applying a projection and pushing it further to, let's say, a selection operator and so on. So here this is a reverted model compared to the pull model. So just for the completeness here, I guess you have worked with this, or all of you have worked with such a pull operator tree already. If you're looking at the here the query that you execute in JDBC, you're obtaining a result set, and then you can call the next method on the result set, and then the result set will produce or return the next result. And this is a good description or a good example for such an operator tree here, where every operator is implementing so-called open next close interfaces. Open just instantiates the or opens the processing, while the next method here that you also see here for the result set is then pulling the result tuples to the top operator. Right? And of course, if this projection wants to have a tuple to process or to output, then this tuple has to be coming or it has to be requested from the selection operator, and this selection operator gets the tuples from the join operator, right? And this is like a pull way, you're pulling at the topmost and all the tuples floating then from the bottom up. In contrast to this, push, which is used in stream processing, is data driven. So you have here an operator. Let's say again, simply a projection. This is one operator, and here you have a selection operator. Then the projection operator will register at the selection operator. So the selection is then aware that there is the projection operator which wants to read or wants to consume data from the selection operator. And whenever there's now a tuple coming in here from the further down operators, this tuple will be processed by the selection predicate and then actively pushed to the projection operator. And at the bottom, we have, of course, here some data sources, for instance, a temperature data source, a sensor, and here there are temperature readings. And whenever there's a new reading, this will be pushed to higher level operators which have registered at this data source. This is like the idea. This, in the end, can be modeled using a directed acyclic graph, DAG, and is called topology in later systems we investigate. So here's an illustration of a simple query plan in stream. We have here different streams coming in, three streams. There are queues here between the individual operators. Here we see a join operator, here as well, and here a selection operator, and the data in this model is flowing from the bottom to the top, and here in the end we have the query results. And this is also a nice example because you see here that the two queries, Q1 and Q2, are sharing quite a substantial amount of processing. So this part here, the join between two streams, is shared across these two queries, Q1 and Q2. So there's only this selection necessary for Q1 additionally. And further on here, we have for Q2 a join with stream 3. Yes, so you have operators, queues, and states associated with the individual operators, for instance, carrying synopsis data, the hash table, for instance, for a hash-based join, and so on. Now, these queues are there in order to organize the communication between the producer and the consumer operator. Conceptually, it's simply a FIFO buffer, so you're inserting and retrieving in timestamp orders the tuples in and from that queue, and you can have also multiple consumers. So there could be another consumer here that is also reading from that queue. So this is not any more like a purely push-based situation, also the overall picture is still the same. However, these operators or these queues, they allow decoupling operators. So the consumer will read from a queue and the producer will write to a queue. Still, this can be done in a way that the queue can also inform the operators, up-level operators, that there is a new item coming. When looking at distributed data stream management systems, the first observation is that conceptually they behave similar to a centralized one. There are also multiple approaches published in the literature and also system-wise. We have already seen Stream, which also falls into this category. There's Borealis, there's Global Sensor Networks, and so on. There are really also here more than a handful of different approaches. We will specifically look at very recent distributed data stream management systems for big data in a scale-out architecture. Here, there have been also some approaches proposed. For instance, Yahoo S4, which is then also maintained by Apache, and Storm, which was developed or proposed by Twitter and then also became an Apache project. There's also Spark Streaming, so the extension for Spark for streaming data. And as I said, many concepts are very generic. For instance, topologies and the operator interfaces and so on. And to some extent, this will also remind you on MapReduce or the MapReduce paradigm. So systems like Storm, they're aiming at guaranteed data processing, at fault tolerance, of course, at horizontal scalability, so scale-out architecture, and they should enable high-level programming, ideally. So this sounds like MapReduce, as I said. However, there's of course a big difference. Here we see Apache Storm, or Twitter Storm, which is sometimes referred to as the real-time Hadoop. This was developed by Nathan Mars, who went then to Twitter, and then this also became eventually an Apache project. Data operators here can be put on different machines in a network, so this is really then also a scale-out architecture behind Storm. Here's a simple depiction of a typical Storm cluster setup. You have the so-called supervisor nodes. These are here in this case worker nodes. On the right-hand side here shown, a so-called Nimbus, which is the coordinator node, like the job tracker node in Hadoop. This of course can differ also depending on the versions of Storm, like in Hadoop as well. And here in this version, we see here Apache Zookeeper for the coordination between the Nimbus and the supervisor nodes. Very briefly, Zookeeper is a service, also an Apache project, that enables highly reliable distributed coordination. You can think of something like Paxos here. So there is like the Zookeeper service involving multiple servers, and one of the servers is elected the leader, and then the clients can use or can access using a simple API, a hierarchical data model, and this Zookeeper service is used to implement higher level applications, and this Storm is using Zookeeper for the coordination. That means Storm uses Zookeeper for discovery of nodes, storing states of the Nimbus and the supervisor nodes, and guaranteeing message processing and tracking, and for statistics. The actual communication is not done using Zookeeper, but through special libraries directly between the individual supervisor nodes. So there's no queues here. There's direct communication between the nodes that are doing the computation. We talk about topologies, which are consisting of spouts and bolts. Spouts are data sources and bolts are the operators. And as you can imagine here, we have the data sources producing tuples. These are then consumed by the bolts and forwarded to further on bolts, depending on your query. Right? So the spouts are data sources, the bolts are operators, and the topology is a composition of spouts and bolts, depending on your query. So here's a simple example how you're creating such a topology. There's the so-called topology builder class in the API. So you're creating a new builder object, and then with the builder object, you're creating a topology, in this case, a simple topology that consumes words from this spout on the left side, and adding to every word in this example an exclamation symbol and another one. Right? In these cases here, we call these exclamation bold. It's a class, an implementation of a bold. And here you see that there are two of these bolds connected for the simple example. So first of all, we tell the topology builder that we are creating a spout. So it's data source. We call this spout words. And we have a class behind that spout, which is called test word spout. Let's ignore the numbers here for a moment. And then now the interesting part is that we now tell the builder that we want to have an operator, so a bold. We call it operator exclaim one. This is here. And here's the class name for this exclaim bold. And now the interesting part is that we have to register now using this shuffle grouping on the data source called words. And this is exactly here, the data source called words, our spout. And by using this command here, now the exclaim bold has registered to receive all the output tuples from the spout words. As you can see, we have another operator here, another exclamation bold, which is consuming the output from the exclamation bold 1, which is called exclaim 1 here. And so we're creating another bold, exclaim 2, which is then subscribing on exclaim 1. Again, using shuffle grouping. The shuffle grouping is to tell the topology how the tuples are coming from the one operator to the other operator, in this case from the spout to the bold. Because you can have, of course, or you will have, not only one of these instances of exclamation bold here, but you will have multiple. You have many of these in your scale-out architecture and many of these, right? Perhaps also many of these spouts, right? So this is only the depiction of the topology, but then you have multiple instances at different machines implementing the or executing the task described by these bolts or spouts. And if you have now multiple of these bolts here, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and here you have 1, 2, 3, you have to somehow direct how the tuples are coming from the spout to the instances of the bolt. You can have, for instance, a random grouping, so there's a tuple being produced here at one of these instances, and then the random grouping, which is exactly the shuffle grouping, would send this tuple to any of these instances here for the exclaim one bolt. You can also do group by and so on. We will have a slide for this specifically later. So what about the numbers here? So first of all, to repeat that, here we give a name to this spout we're creating. So this data source, here's the class name behind that data source, for instance, producing this, producing random words in this example, or reading through some interfaces from a temperature sensor and so on. And here is the so-called parallelization hint. Again, we will in detail look about this a bit later, but this is like indicating how many of the instances of this spout storm should produce and run. So here's the implementation of such a data source, a spout. We have here a spout which emits random words from a specific set. Here the words are simple characters A, B, C, D, E. And now the spout, if you're looking at the API of Storm, like you look also at the API for Spark or MapReduce, the spout is implemented, or the spout is implemented by implementing an interface or inheriting from an abstract class. And there's one method you have to write or override, which is called next tuple. And this tuple is doing some computation, and in the end, like MapReduce, emitting that tuple. And this tuple here is simply, like in this case, a word which is wrapped into a values class here. So the word is simply a string. And as you can see here, the word is taken at a random number from this array words. Right? So the important thing is here, the next tuple function is implemented. And here you have an emit, like in MapReduce, that emits this tuple. Now, when you want to read from this spout, so from this data source using a bold, in our example here, we have a bold that is called exclaim one. Implementation is done in a class called exclamation bold. And what is done here is basically simply receiving a word and adding an exclamation mark behind on the end of the word. And important here is to say, how is the data coming from one instance of the spout to an instance of the bold? And here we have shuffle grouping, which is simply a random grouping. So a random sending of tuples from the spout to the bold. And from which bold do we read? Well, we're specifying here the name of the stream to consume. In this example now, this is a spout. However, this can also be another bold. So bolts can also, of course, consume data from bolts. When implementing a bold, you do not have to implement a next tuple method, but here a so-called execute tuple method, where the tuple comes as a parameter. This is the tuple that comes in, for instance, from another bold or a spout to this bold now. And like in MapReduce, you're and also in the spout earlier, we are emitting something now. And what do we emit? We are emitting the new value of or the new information, which is simply this string contained at the first position of the input tuple, where we're adding three exclamation marks. This is why the bold is called exclamation bold. And additionally, we have here as the first parameter the old tuple. Why is this? Well, this is called the anchor. And by specifying this, the system is able to track the dependency of new tuples to the old tuples. So in case of a failure, a tuple will be lost somewhere. Then we can reconstruct it based on the tuples this tuple, the new tuple, was built on. Also, here we have an acknowledgement that we received the input tuple. Also, this is there for tracking the lineage for fault tolerance reasons. As I mentioned, we have different ways to control the flow of the tuples from one instance of a bold to another instance of the consuming bold, or from a spout to a bold. And we have already seen shuffle grouping, which will simply randomly spread tuples across the consuming operator instances. This is of course good for load balancing, but this is arbitrary of course. Then there is field grouping, which, as the name tells you, groups the tuples based on some fields. And there is all grouping, which means that the tuples are replicated to all of the consumer bold's tasks. There are more groupings, which you can inspect online for full details. You can think of many applications you can realize using Apache Storm. And here there are some given. For instance, you want to count how often hashtags appear in a Twitter stream, or how many times two hashtags appear together. Think about word count in MapReduce. Or you want to compute trends as sudden increases of such occurrences or co-occurrences. So grouping in these cases makes sure that you find all occurrences of the same hashtag or of two hashtags. So you have to think carefully, what is the grouping way and on which fields do you group, much as or similar to what you have done when you come up with word count or pair count applications or algorithms in MapReduce. So how can we compute a join in Apache Storm? Like in MapReduce, we have to see or to make sure that the tuples, which are join partners, find each other. In MapReduce, for the case of equijoin or natural join, we did this, for instance, in the reducer join by emitting the tuples at the map site according to the correct keys. And the keys were the values of the join attributes. And here, this is similar. We're doing this also here for equijoin or natural join. We are writing a class myJoiner, which is doing the actual join computation. So this is pretty much what a reducer would do in MapReduce in the case of the reducer join. Here, this joiner consumes three streams, stream 1, 2, and 3. And how do we make sure now that the tuples from 1, 2, and 3 find each other according to the attributes they have for our join? This is given here. Of course, this needs to be tailored to the join you want to compute. So depending on the schema of these relations that are coming in as a stream, here we group the tuples based on joined field 1 and joined field 2. Of course, this is like really the implementation. You have to read then the incoming tuples and make sure that you're joining only tuples from relation 1 with 2 with 3, and not with another tuple from relation one, right? So you don't want to compute a self-join, but a join between relations 1, 2, and 3. And like in MapReduce, you're then packing your code together in a jar file, including the required dependencies, and submit this jar file to the cluster that is here the Nimbus node, using similar to the Hadoop instructions, the command storm jar, then the jar file in the main package, defining the topology. And then the topology will run, in principle forever, because we talk about a continuous query here, continuous processing, once it is deployed. And much like also Hadoop, you can also here see using an UI how many tuples are processed by the individual bowls here. This is a screenshot based on some paper we wrote some years ago where there were different bowls, like a counter bowl and other bowls, and you see how many executors and tasks there were. This is exactly giving you the indication how many instances of an operator you have. Here you also can see how many tuples have been emitted and transferred, and here also how many have been acknowledged. So regarding the parallelism, very briefly, we have workers, executors, and tasks. There's one or more workers per machine. Workers run in an own Java virtual machine, and the worker is specific to the topology, of course, like the way that is implemented here, or the what you want to implement here. There is one executor per worker. Think of this being a thread. And an executor runs one or more tasks of the same component. So here, you, for instance, you have a bold, the exclaim bold. Then this could mean that this executor runs, let's say, 2 exclaim bolds. You can configure the level of parallelization using a configuration here in Storm. You can set the number of workers, for instance, here to 2. Then when you instantiate a bold, for instance here, the bold implemented in MyBold in the class, you can specify here the number of initial executors and the number of tasks according to the aforementioned slide. So this means we will have 2 executors with 2 tasks each. The default is 1 task per executor. This also, I have to mention this, this might also depend on the version of Storm you're downloading and using. This might change over the years. This is not the latest version, but the concept should still be similar or the same. So what about fault tolerance? Here we can say that when a worker dies, it is just restarted. If a node dies, the worker is moved to a new machine. In order to monitor this, these workers are sending heartbeat messages to the Nimbus. It is interesting that the Nimbus and the supervisors are stateless, so they're not carrying any state. The state is stored in ZooKeeper or on disk, so in a persistent, fault-tolerant way. So the Nimbus and the supervisors just need to be restarted. This is like an interesting concept of fail fast. So they can just fail in case there's any trouble, and then they're getting restarted. And whenever they fail, it is taken care of and, due to supervision, that this is noticed, the failing, and they can be restarted. So they're designed to fail fast. Running jobs are not lost, they're kept persistently. So how do we make sure now that the messages are processed in the way they should? To some extent, this is taking care of that the bolds are acknowledging the correct processing using this ACK method we have seen in the example. This means that the producing operators, so more up in the operator topology, they see or at least they have the chance to see that the tuple was properly processed. And in case they do not see that, there can be, after a timeout, the resending of the tuple be triggered. Or instead of timeout, there can be a fail method directly asking for the resend of this tuple. And this is also where anchored versus unanchored comes in. So when you have a tuple coming in, you can connect the incoming tuple to the resulting tuple. So here we have the collector.admit. Here this is the anchoring tuple and here's the new tuple. And then in case something goes wrong, the tuple can be recreated or replayed. The process can be replayed based on the function that needs to be called again, this execute from a bold. Tuples can also have multiple anchors. If you're looking at the API, you see that you can also have a list of tuples for this first parameter here of emit. Inside Storm, there's a special anchor task that keeps track about the acknowledgement of these individual tuples. So now when looking at this in the previous slides and the similarity to MapReduce, remember the discussion we had that MapReduce was too low level and then people wanted to have a higher level abstraction like Hive or Pig. Well, this was also done in Storm and there's Trident, which is a high level abstraction on top of Storm, and you have it easier now using statements like group by or aggregate to write your queries or your topology and not going for the low level routines of Storm, how it's given in the simple API. Yeah, some literature on this chapter, and this is then concluding the part on data stream processing.